I will give you a very short presentation as a greetings, dear students and guests, to our laboratory, what we call Epigenetics and Chromatin Research Laboratory, and partly it is located at the University of Szeged in the Department of Biochemistry and Molecular Biology, and partly at the BRC in the Biochemical Institute. And the student who will show some results, what she performed at this laboratory is Petra Éva, who is a second year student in this program. And what our major interest is epigenetics, and for the introduction of epigenetics, let me show you a few pictures. It is known by all of you, I'm sure, that DNA determines the synthesis of messenger RNA, and messenger RNA will serve for the synthesis of proteins, and the proteins, their activity will determine the specific features of the organisms, like here in these twins, but also in modeled animals, what we use frequently, and of course, all these based on the function of cells, which are dividing here. And when there are mistakes in this process, then this will lead to different disease states. However, this determination of the protein, and by this the phenotype, with the genotypes of the DNA is very greatly influenced by the environment, and this effect of the environment, what is basically the epigenetic effect. Epigenetics, which is how the DNA is read, when it is read, and how it is interpreted in the cell. The major components on this environment contribution is the modification of the DNA in the form of methylations at specific C residues, and the packaging of the DNA with the histone proteins, the so-called nucleosome structure, which is the major interest in our laboratory, in which a basic protein octamer, the histone octet, forms a nucleus on which the DNA is rubbed around, and on this structure, the DNA, which is almost 2 meters in length, can fit in the nucleus of a few micrometer cell. However, in order to perform the biological function of the DNA, this nucleosome structure should be modified and accessed by the many proteins which participate in the transcription. And our studies are very much targeted to this, related to this, and in recent years we have shown that the modification of specific proteins which are present in yeast, in Drosophila, and also in humans, in large complexes, contribute to the modification of the histones, and depending on the activity of histone acetyltransferases, kinases, the DNA can take a form in which it can be transcribed, producing proteins, or by the action of a methylase, it can be compacted and forming a heterochromatin. In relation on this, Petra's work concerns how the cells can turn on genes in response to drug and became resistant to drugs. It is a very important question relating to cancer treatment, and she will introduce it in more details. I just would like to call your attention that in our laboratory we are primarily interested, as I have mentioned, these modifications on the packaging of the DNA and how this affects the drug resistance of the tumor cells, and all these are based on previous studies what we published already on histone modifications in tumor cells. The laboratory consists of several students and postdocs, and supported by different grants among these prestigious fellowship program. And we have very wide collaborations all over the world. As a matter of fact, Andreas Ladurner from Munich just arriving tomorrow and will present a seminar on Monday at the BRC. And Yannis Talianidis at Greece will in Athens welcome Petra for a summer school program during the summer for a 4-week period. And thank you very much for your attention. I ask Petra now to do the presentation.
It is safe to assume that cancer is one of the most pressurizing problems of modern healthcare, since it is the second most common cause of death in high-income countries. Also, treatment of cancer can last for years, and it comes with very high treatment costs. One of the traditional ways of treating cancer is the use of chemotherapy, when we try to kill the cells with the use of cytotoxic drugs. But sadly, cancer cells can acquire resistance against these drugs, and this causes a very poor response for the treatment. One way of acquiring drug resistance is the overexpression of ABC transporters. ABC transporters are transmembrane pumps which can hydrolyze ATP, and with the energy of ATP hydrolyzation, they can pump out different molecules from the cells. The most common ABC transporter is called MDR1, and it's oftenly expressed in cancer cells. Because of this, ABC transporters are important prognostic factors, because if a patient's cancer cell can express ABC transporters, the chance for success of treatment is very low. Because of this, pharmacologists try to develop inhibitors of ABC transporters. But sadly, these inhibitors all failed in clinical trials. The main reason for that was that healthy tissues can also express ABC transporters in big amounts. For example, the blood-brain barrier also contains a lot of ABC transporters, and because of this, one of the main side effects for these inhibitors was very strong headaches. Besides, they found out that these inhibitors don't elongate patient survival time, so there was a reason to shut down the clinical trials. Nowadays, the need is to find a treatment to conquer MDR, multidrug resistance, in cancer cells without these side effects. Collateral sensitivity is a finding that proves a solution for the problem. If we treat a cancer cell with a drug, it can acquire drug resistance. If the drug-resistant cell is then treated with another drug, it most commonly shows drug resistance to this other drug also. But in some rare cases, they found that the drug-resistant cancer cells can be more sensitive to specific drugs than they were before the treatment. In this case, the cells either die or they lose their ability to express ABC transporters. Our collaborators are working on finding these drug-cell interactions, and they asked us to have a deeper look at the molecular mechanisms of the process. They gave us four human uterine sarcoma cell lines, P18, which is a resistant cell line, P18-NTR2, which is a sensitive cell line made with a treatment of a collateral sensitivity-causing drug, P24, which is also a sensitive cell line, and 31, which is made from NTR2 with the use of another chemotherapeutic drug, and it is also resistant. At first, we checked the phenotype of the cells. We used the fluorescent ABC transporter substrate and then sorted the cells based on their rate of fluorescence. And we found that in the resistant cell lines, there is much less of this fluorescent dye than in the sensitive cell lines. As we are all aware, the information in the cells flows in the direction of DNA, mRNA, protein, and finally cell function. And there are many steps in which this process can be regulated. So our first goal was to find which is the step that is crucial in this case. First, we take a look at the MDR1 protein level, and we found that MDR1 protein is present in much higher levels in the resistant cell lines than in the sensitive cell lines. The mRNA level is also similar. It can be 100 times higher in resistant cell lines than in sensitive cell lines. One of the possible explanations for this is gene amplification, when the copy number of the MDR1 gene changes. So we checked if that's the case. But we didn't find evidence of gene amplification happening, since the copy number was approximately the same in each cell lines. So if the DNA itself didn't change, then it's possible that the DNA binding proteins caused the difference. So we used chromatin immunoprecipitation, which is a method to specifically find proteins bound to a given section of the gene. We examined the promoter region, the exon, and the end of the MDR1 gene. also several author reference genes. And we found that RNA polymerase II, which is mainly responsible for mRNA transcription, binds more frequently for the different regions of the MDR1 gene in the resistant cell lines than in the sensitive. So it's proven that these cells are more transcriptionally active in this gene. One possible explanation for this is the role of histone acetylation, which can cause the DNA structure to loosen up, so it causes the cells to be more transcriptionally active. So we checked if there is a difference in the level of histone acetylation in the cell lines. And we found that the level of histone acetylation is mildly elevated in the resistant cell lines, in the sense of a general effect. And finally, we used a couple of histone acetylation changing drugs to see if we administer these drugs, they can cause a change in cell function. We used TSA, tyrosine A, which can elevate histone acetylation, and we found that the resistant cell lines start to lose their resistance if we administer this drug, which is a very curious finding, but it proves that acetylation has a clear role in the process. So finally, we observed the change in the cell function. We checked the protein level, the mRNA level, but we didn't find evidence of gene amplification happening. So we come down to the conclusion that the main difference is in the transcriptional regulation. And we observed the role of histone acetylation of the process as deeply as in the change of histone acetylation can indeed change cell function. So in the future, we want to look at other histone and DNA modifications, for example, DNA methylation, the binding of other transcriptional factors, and also the distributed of acetylated histones on the gene. I want to thank my mentor, Professor Imre Boros, and also the staff members of the Epigenetic and Chromatin Research Laboratory and the Department of Biochemistry and Molecular Biology. Thank you for your attention.